All right, have we admitted any members of the public that have attempted to join?
None to this point.
Okay. All right, so in that case, we'll call the meeting to order. Well, first we'll have the Pledge of Allegiance. Everyone could please stand. Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America
and to the Republic
for which it stands,
one nation, one God, indivisible, with liberty
and justice for all.
Thank you. If we could have roll call, please.
Chair Buzzell.
Present.
Vice Chair Firestone.
Present.
Commissioner Ramirez. Absent at this time. Commissioner Vogue.
Here.
Commissioner Chang.
Here.
And alternate Tobiano.
Here.
Commissioner Ramirez sent an email today, said he was undergoing a dental procedure and wasn't sure he would be completely coherent by the time of the meeting. He was going to try, but apparently he didn't fare as well as you, Chair.
Thank you. I did see that. I hope he's doing well. Moving on to the agenda. The agenda was posted 72 hours prior to the meeting at City Hall, the Crowell Public Library, and the Recreation Department. It was also posted on the city's website. Moving on to public comments, this is the portion of the meeting where we allow members of the public to make comments on items that are not on the agenda, but seeing we have one hand.
Yes.
Mr.
I'm Ken Udy. I live on Twin Palms in San Marino, and I've been talking to people in the neighborhood, and we all think that the little stanchions with the tacky signs and the blinky lights at the Sherwood and West Drive are tacky and not necessary on a four-way stop. And if it is necessary then I would ask the commission, why isn't the same type of, you know, tackiness down on Virginia and Lorraine or across from the church on Virginia? And if you feel that it is appropriate and necessary, then we would encourage you to do something that's professional and not tacky. And I would take the same comment over to the stanchions on, I think it's what, Cumberland, that if we're gonna do something in town that's important to safety, let's do it right. Let's not do it tacky. Thank you.
Director Stroner, I invite you to respond to those comments in your report later, because I believe those changes and updates and intersections are part of your report. Anybody else have any comments from the public that are for items that are not on the agenda? Seeing no other hands, we'll move on to commissioner reports. Have any members of the commission attended any meetings or conferences that they wish to inform the public about?
No.
Seeing none, we'll move on to department reports. And first up is the police department report. Chief Incontro.
Good evening, Chair and Public Safety Commission. You have my report in front of you. I just wanted to highlight just a couple of different items. On page six, draw your attention to a analysis that one of our detectives did on the 14 residential burglaries we've had since 2021. What's frustrating above all else is prior to that, we only had 14 residential burglaries. We're still below, as you can tell with our stats of crime this year compared to last. If you read the paper, watch the news, you can see that follow home burglaries, follow home robberies, commercial robberies and burglaries throughout the county have a considerable uptick and a considerable amount of violence. But for several things that we found with the analysis is of the homes, four homes were vacant, two were under construction, which do not fall under the vacant home policy that we have, ordinance. The other six homes, the people were not home at all during the burglary. Two of the homes where there was, they were not, the six homes where there was not vacant, the residents just were not home at the time. For almost every incident, the point of entry was to the rear. Very little activity occurs in the front of the home, and especially with some of the sizes of our lots, the amount of trees, bushes, gates, walls, the back is more conducive to being hidden and committing a successful burglary. Of the 14, one home had a security system that was actually on and working. And the other home that had a security system was not working. 10 of the homes did not have any kind of security system at all, which causes us a lot of difficulty. Recently, we had a burglary at the Chevron station across from the station. That business had an alarm, but it went to the resident or to the owner of the business. And there was several minutes where we were not informed of the burglary. We had to wait for the owner of the property to call us. And we responded, and according to the video, we missed the crooks by 1 minute. So if we had been contacted quicker by the alarm company, or that the alarm company followed some of the protocol that we have in place where they call us at the same time as the owner of the property, the resident of the property, then we would have probably caught the people involved. But unfortunately, that was not the case. We've produced some videos for preventing burglaries. We're also working on informing the community, and we've started to do that a little bit on all of these crimes that are occurring primarily in Los Angeles and West Side. And one of the things that we're also working with Torrance Police Department. Yesterday in the news, they announced that there has been a series of follow home robberies of Asian residents at gated communities who have businesses out of the city of Torrance. So we've reached out to Torrance. The detective that's involved in those investigations is going to contact us, or we're going to contact them and talk to them specifically about the crimes. If there's any connection to our residents, if this is bigger than just the city of Torrance, they've put out a information bulletin that we will tailor more to our community. We feel that it's important to inform them to be careful. We're not seeing any kind of issues that are occurring other places in the county, but we still want to inform the community. With the new community engagement manager on board today, I already spoke to her this morning about launching our Instagram account. More people are paying attention to Instagram than Facebook, and we can put out smaller videos. We can put out information on Instagram that will get to probably a broader audience. At least that's what we're aiming for, and using some of the other social media tools that we have. We currently have two vacancies in the city, and we have one lateral candidate who is just starting the process. And with a lateral candidate, from the time that they apply to the time that they are in the field, if things go well, we could have that as short as 45 days. So we're trying to find and concentrate on our lateral police officer candidates over our candidates that have to go to the police academy. And we're also working on a plan for hopefully don't have to worry about it, but in the event that the officers are not, the number of officers who don't want to comply with the mandated vaccine program, that we have something in place to keep the community safe. And spoke to about four different attorneys in the past week and a half, and worked with them and got better guidance on some ideas that I had. So that's still a very raw work in progress at this time. Other than that, again, the flock cameras are helping us. You can see that we have the feds helping us on one of the crimes. And we have been working with Flock to place the additional 8 cameras that were approved in the last budget. That is my report. And if you have any questions, I'm available.
Chief, on social media, I saw a post about a grant that we received. Can you tell us about that?
Yes. Well, we received an Office of Traffic Safety grant. That grant has 2 parts. The first part is some software for the officers when they are conducting traffic collision investigations, that information will be uploaded automatically to a program the state uses and traffic engineers use called SWTRS. So there's no delay in doing manual entry on that information. And also we will be getting some handheld devices that will enable us to write traffic and parking citations that will allow us to input traffic collision information. And that information will go directly to SWTRS. It will also help us with the racial profiling information that we are required to put in, provide the state. We are starting the beginning of the program January 1st, and the handheld devices with the software that we would prefer to get, we know we have to get 3 bids, but the one that we prefer to get will enable us to do the completion of the form in about 90 seconds versus 10 minutes by hand. And we will not have to use any personnel to do the downloading. So it's a very positive use of technology. Also, we will be using those for almost a daily basis. We're looking at that. The second part of the grant is DUI or driving under the influence task forces, some traffic task forces, and decoy operations, and also for education of the community and with the schools. So we're very excited about that.
I also noticed that you attached to your report the district attorney's special directive. Was there something you wanted to discuss with the commission about that directive?
I understand that there were some questions about it. And this is just the misdemeanor directive, and it deals with misdemeanors. And I think it gives the commission a better understanding of what we have to deal with when it comes to trying to get filings on misdemeanor crimes. Majority of our crimes are misdemeanors, and they're quality of life crimes. So as you look through the misdemeanor case management document from the DA, there are issues about why they decline crimes. And some of it are if there's any possibility of mental illness or homelessness, there usually has to be a significant amount of prior, like a trespass, disturbing the peace. There's also has to be an imminent risk to public safety where before you never had that. Additionally, if you look through the diversion, it is pre-arraignment, post-arraignment diversion. So more than likely, there will not be any kind of filing. There will not be any opportunity for anyone being held accountable. And that's some people believe that some of the issues that we're having with the shoplifting are directly related to this. And, you know, just looking at resisting arrest, there has to be repeat offenses when you're engaging and involved in a fight or refusing to submit to an arrest. So it's a lot of difficult things. On felonies, the LA County Chiefs And we don't have that one attached, but the LA County Chiefs were trying to get some kind of consistency in their filing. So they went from filing at a local court to now there's a central group downtown that will evaluate all filings. It has its pluses and minuses, but our detectives always have a relationship with the filing deputies at the local court. So no longer will we have that. It's all done electronically, so we don't have any face-to-face opportunity or conversations with the filing deputies. And that's a negative. When you can't establish a relationship and when you can't, just the personal relationship and knowing with people and face-to-face and showing the importance of why this case needs to be filed, we lose that opportunity.
Has this directive had impact on how your department is policing?
How it's policing? No, absolutely not. If someone commits a crime and an arrest is appropriate, we are going to make an arrest. Misdemeanors, we write them a ticket in the field and away they go. Sometimes we will take them to Pasadena Police Department jail if there's a need to be able to identify who the person is. Maybe they don't have good identification, a common name, some similarities in their identification. So we'll do that. But in most cases, we write them a ticket at the location where the crime occurred and say you're free to go. Kind of problematic, but we're not putting people in jail because of overcrowding. And the courts have a zero bail policy in place.
Do any other commissioners have questions for Chief Incontro? Seeing no others, do I have a motion to receive and file the police department report?
I move.
Director Bo, thank you. Second. Director, Commissioner Chang, I made you a director. Commissioner Bo.
Moving up in the world.
Commissioner Chang, thank you very much. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, the motion carries and we'll move on to the fire department report. Chief Rueda.
Good evening. Again, you have my report. I just wanted to touch upon a few important pieces of information. Under the city's COVID-19 response, I wanted to point out that our youth that are capable, that are able to get the vaccination, the data shows we're almost at 95% of those eligible, 12 through 17 years old, and our seniors at 95%, which is very good news. However, all the age group in between is hovering right around 57%, which is the group we probably need to focus on. In the last month, since November 6th, we've had 29 cases of COVID reported in our city. And that's fairly consistent with what the firefighters have observed in the field. A number of those were very serious cases that the firefighters transported to Huntington Memorial. We don't know the outcome data, but at least two of our residents were in very, very serious condition when we transported. The good news is, at least from initial indications, the Omicron variant doesn't seem to be as virulent as previous strains. So that may be good news for us, but we'll continue to monitor that. By and large, the rest of the fire department's activities has been focused on training and testing the four probationary firefighters that we have. We conducted a 12-month examination, an 8-month examination, and a 4-month examination for three of the firefighters. All were successful, but require a tremendous amount of work to get them to that point. And we're still hopeful we'll keep all four of them, and we're working hard with human resources to open up hiring for one vacant position that we do have currently. And that concludes my report. If you have any questions.
Any questions from any commissioners? Seeing none, do I have a motion to approve, to receive and file the fire department report? Commissioner Firestone, thank you. Second. Commissioner Bowe, thank you very much. All in favor? Any opposed? Seeing no opposition, the motion carries, and we'll move on to the Public Works Department report. Director Throne.
Thank you, Chair Buzel. You do have my report in front of you, and I would like to add some things. As a follow-up item from your last meeting, Mr. John Dustin remarked that there seemed to be a dearth of speed limit signs on westbound Houston. So we went out, we determined that it needed more signs. So we installed one more, and possibly, I think we installed two additional speed limit signs on Houston going in the westbound direction. So I wanted to let you know that that was taken care of. Another item that did come up was just if I could make a quick update on the wayfinding sign program that the commission reviewed and discussed earlier this year. I did talk to the community development department. They have had some challenges in the last 2 months or so with personnel staffing, but I can report that the program is on hold currently. They're still looking at, they're still reviewing where the signs are going to be placed. And then once they do that, they will reconnect with the commission and let you know where they are and how where they're landing with that. So I want to let you know that it's not been forgotten. It's just taken a lesser priority given some of their more urgent planning issues and issuing building permits. As it relates to what Citizen Udy brought up, we are kind of in a very interesting challenge with these signs. These signs are very effective. These are the W11-15 signs. They show a bicycle on the top and a pedestrian on the bottom. These are the correct signs to use to alert drivers that there's bikes and peds in the area. At that particular intersection that he brings up, the Lorraine and West, there actually is a traffic review we had performed that I attached. Their main recommendations is to update all the signs. The signs we have out there are they are correct for when they were installed probably 10 years ago. They're not current anymore. And so we're going to embark on a sign refreshing program there on West at Lorraine and at Sherwood. The signs that he's mentioning that are on the A-frames at the West, West and Sherwood intersection, we originally placed those on posts along the side of the road. We actually had those signs brought out. We were getting concerns from the residents there that yes, there's an all-way stop and yes, there's a crossing guard. People are still having problems paying attention to that intersection. Is there something we can do? So we thought by posting those signs along the roadway, along the side of the roadway, which is where they normally go, would help alleviate the problem. The feedback we got from the residents was that you can't see the signs because they're off the side of the road. So we elected to do the put the signs on the barricades in the parking lane as a compromise measure. We used those signs very successfully over on Cumberland. They were our first test street on those signs. The reports that we've been receiving for over a year now is that the signs are very effective in reducing traffic. We have a request in from the from Ridgeway south of Huntington to do the same thing. It's not ideal, and we can certainly make sure that the barricades we put out there are new and attractive looking and not the stuff that we have in the back of the shop kind of thing. But they do make a very definite impact. Putting them along the roadway, they just get lost as another sign along the street. And that's kind of been our challenge with alerting drivers that they need to slow down. During the pandemic, we followed the example of both City of Los Angeles and City of Pasadena of alerting drivers by placing signs on a temporary basis in the center of streets that it's suitable, the streets are wide enough, and also putting flashing light on there so that folks can see them at night. We've received nothing but great feedback on those neighborhoods, the Cumberland neighborhood, as I mentioned, and the other one. When we go in and replace the signs on West at Sherwood and Lorraine, we will probably move those signs off just because we don't want to have too much confusion of signs and test it that way. That's one of the things that we do. We do entertain this these requests from neighborhoods. We ask them to report back. Generally speaking, there's one or two residents that speak for that block, and they are very free at letting us know if the signs are working or if they're not working or if they're missing or if they should move to a different location. There are eyes in the neighborhood, and they do let us know about those things. So we will take a look again at this intersection. I apologize if the barricades that they're on are used up. I can certainly take care of that. And as I mentioned, I have attached for you the signage program that we're going to be, the refreshing signage program we're going to be doing on West. At the time of publication, I was hoping to get Mission Street at Euclid. I just received that today. And so you'll be able to see that at your next meeting. At that particular intersection, we're going to be enlarging some of the stop signs, which may be problematic because they're already large and it's a business district. There's other things we could do, but after a point, we max out on what we could do as it relates to signage. About the maximum amount of signage we could do is, I believe, the intersection of Sherwood and St. Albans. We have very large stop signs that are on red posts, and that's and refreshing the painting and doing, you know, crosswalks as appropriate, and putting the supplemental panel of all way stop. At that point, it's really it exhausts what I can do. And so the other factor to change the driver behavior is Chief Encontro's excellent police force. And that does work for a while. Then it's as soon as they're not there for a period, people's bad behaviors to return. Outside that does conclude my report. And I wanna thank Citizen Udy for bringing this to my attention. We'll go and take a look at that. And when we have these signs ordered and installed, the other signs will remove. We will be keeping them in the Cumberland area for the time being, because those folks are reporting that they are working successfully. Well, I will make sure that we're putting them on a nicer facility.
I was on mute there. Thank you, Director Throne. Any questions from the commissioners? Commissioner Bowe.
Not wishing to disagree with Citizen Udy, but I live roughly at the corner of Sherwood and West Drive. And I will admit he's correct that they do appear to be unusual for our city. I assumed they were there temporarily to get my attention, and they have. And if they keep people from running over the kids, I'm all for it, even though they don't measure up with the standards that I would expect. But I assume that once you put the final signs in, that they'll probably be replaced or with the final signs. But, yeah, they sure got my attention, and I'm glad they did.
Any additional questions or comments from the commission? Any additional public comment, Citizen Udy?
Yeah, I would encourage you to solve a problem that exists. Because when I looked at the data in the last, 6 years, there have been a couple of accidents there. There's a crossing guard at that intersection when the kids are there. Mm-hmm. And I just don't think we want to visually litter up everything. And what's there today is really tacky. And I understand it's temporary, but if you're saying Cumberland has been there for a while and that's working, then if it's working, let's make it look good. Like across from Coolidge School going down into San Gabriel, there are ways to make it look good. And then I would encourage the commission and staff to not take a sample from one person like me, but really sample the neighborhood. Because, you know, if you have one or two whistleblowers and if something happens, again, this is a problem in my mind that does, no, it's not a problem that needs a solution. Thank you.
Any other comments from anybody? Seeing none, do I have a motion to receive and file the Public Work Department report? Commissioner Chang, thank you very much. A second. Commissioner Firestone, thank you. All in favor? That looks like everybody. Motion passes, and we'll move on to approval of the minutes. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes from our November 1st meeting? Commissioner Bowe, thank you. Second. Commissioner Firestone, all in favor of approving the minutes from the November 1st meeting? That looks like everybody. So the motion passes. moving on, do we have any suggestions from any commissioners for future agenda items? Seeing none now, if there are suggestions that come up in the course of the next couple of weeks, feel free to email them to the staff, appropriate staff, or Commissioner Firestone and I, and we'll discuss them at our agenda setting meeting. And that brings us to the end of our meeting. So I have a motion to adjourn. Commissioner Bowe, thank you. Seconded by Commissioner Firestone. Thank you very much. Happy holidays, everybody. We will see you after the new year, and we are adjourned.